Professor Rick Del Santo, and joining me today is a legend in the business, the Guardian of Chaos, Big Daddy. Big Daddy, how the hell are you today?
Professor, thanks for having me here on the show. First off, Professor, it's about 90 degrees out. We are on the first day of summer. Tonight is the summer solstice, and I can't wait. Later on, my wife and I are going to go out. We're going to check out the sunset and the solstice. But I just want to thank you, Professor, for having me here on your show. It's an honor and a pleasure.
I am very excited. Thank you for coming on. So why don't you tell me, how'd you get a little involved in the world of professional wrestling?
Well, Ricky, that's a great question. Nobody really asks me those questions. You know that I'm on the Mario and Chaos show.
Correct.
We're on all social media platforms, everything from Apple to iHeart to iTunes to Stitcher. We're on YouTube. We're on Facebook. You know that I'm on the worldwide Dino Costa show on Chaos Corner every Thursday night. And the one thing that is never, you know, I do the broadcasting and the commentary for Paradise Alley Pro Wrestling, which you're well aware of.
Yep.
And the one thing, Professor, that most people don't ask me, so I want to thank you right there, is they really ask me about what I've done for my career, because I'm usually with a bunch of stars, whether
right.
former WWE guys like Mario Mancini or Paul Roma, the legend from WCW and the Four Horsemen, or Paul Perez or Big Dave Paradise, or even the Paradise Alley stars like Richard Holiday, Vlad, Matias DiNapoli, the House of Pain, Showtime, Marcel Williams. So you're around a lot of different people. This is what I can say. 1984, Rick, we're going to go way back to 1984, is when the Guardian of Chaos, I was probably at that point 20 or 21 years old, and I went to the legendary Quest facility in Orange, which was being run by the former Mr. USA, Kenny Passarillo, and the trainers and the students down there was Tough Tony Alfamori from the legendary Sicilians who teamed with Captain Lou Albano, the Stanford Stomp. We know that. So the trainer in there was Mario Mancini, my old friend, my current podcast partner. So I walked in there, Professor, in great shape, Southern Connecticut State University, was briefly on the wrestling team, to be honest with you, just to get the warm-up outfit because it got all the chicks, Rick. So
I wrestled myself in high school. So
I heard you were quite the athlete,
yep.
friend. So we went, a couple of us, you know, we were bodybuilding, we were powerlifting, right. I was bouncing in all the local clubs, the legendary Daniels in Montego Bay back in the day. I was in great shape. So I decided I wanted to be a pro wrestler, Rick, because as a kid, back to the 70s, I was a pro wrestling fan as a young boy. And some of my earliest memories are at the old New Haven Arena, seeing Bruno Sammartino defend against Tor Kamada. Circa 1972, Stan the Man Stasiak was on there. Baron Mikhail Cicluna, Jimmy and Johnny Valiant, the Valiant brothers. So that's how far I go back. And my parents said to me, you know what, we're going to take him to a wrestling match and he'll see how fake it is. And he'll never go and we'll never have to come put up with this bullshit ever again. Well, when they did that, I got more involved and more invested. And even back in the 70s, I started my own backyard wrestling group in the 70s. That's how far back I go. Fast forward to the 80s, being in college, being in great shape. I went down to the Quest facility to be trained. Now, everybody had passed through that school, from Dr. D. David Schultz to Tony Atlas, Tony Gurria, the Wild Samoans. There were a lot of famous people that came through there. All the WWF stars, whenever they came to Connecticut, which that's where the home headquarters is, and they came down our way, they all went to the Quest to train. I went in there, and I got to be honest, my first day I got in the ring, Mario beat me from pillar to post, Professor. Beel after beel. Body slam after body slam. Hindu squats forever. I could barely walk. After about 2 weeks of taking a pounding, I'll never forget the first day I walked out, I could barely move. Now, mind you, I was in pretty great shape back then and did a lot of different things. It was the toughest thing I ever did. I walked out of the school after 2 weeks, still owing a balance on my tuition fee. And it was the hardest thing I ever did. And I got to admit, and I'll be honest with you, Rick, at that point in my life, I could not do it. I couldn't make it. I couldn't cut the mustard. I didn't have what it took. It was a lot tougher than I thought it was going to be for a guy who was even in great shape as a young guy. But the training was a lot different in the 80s than it is nowadays. the training facilities, the dojos. You look at MTV Tough Enough and what they put out in the 21st century. You go back to the 80s and any star will tell you how different and how tough the training was. But the bottom line is, Ricky, back then, I had injuries. I didn't tell anybody. It's well documented in my Hall of Fame speech. I had broken my lower back, both my ankles, my legs. I didn't tell anybody that. That happened when I was 16, 17 years old. At this point, I was 21 and recovered. So I didn't let on. I don't want to use that as an excuse.
Right.
I couldn't cut the mustard then. I didn't make it. That's how it started, Professor.
So when did you get into the business as a manager? You came back a few years later, correct?
Came back a few years later, 1988 and 89, where I traveled with one of my buddies, Lenny, who hooked us up with the Samoan SWAT team at the time. But I'm going to go even further back before I went to the wrestling school at Quest and Mario Mancini and Tony Altomori. I had originally met the Tonga Kid when he was 18 years old, 17 or 18 years old. I was bouncing at Daniels, going to Southern Connecticut, and the Tonga Kid and the Samoans came into the nightclub. And that's where I first originally got my hooks into the business and traveled all over with Tonga and the Samoans before I even went to the school. Plus, I was training at World Gym, Jerry Mastrangelo, Mike Katz, former Mr. USA, the legendary gym where I ran into Ivan Putski, Jesse the Body Ventura, Don Morocco, Mr. Fuji. So the stories go on and on where I've been influenced as a young man from a teenager to where I met the stars. So that's originally how it all, I got the fever and trained and learned from everyone. Go to 88, 89. I traveled with the Samoan SWAT team with a good friend of mine. We were down in WCW. I was not in the business, still learning the business, still trying to think I could make it as a full-time grappler, but obviously it wasn't meant to be. I learned the business, ran into the Steiners, the Road Warriors, Luger, Sting, the SST, Michael Hayes, and I have a legendary story we can get to that you might have heard before about the Road Warriors, the Samoan SWAT team, and the Guardian of Chaos. A pretty humbling story, my friend.
Yeah, why don't you tell that story for the listeners?
Well, here's the story. So we're traveling WCW, Samoan SWAT team, are feuding with the Road Warriors at that time.
It's 1989?
This is 89.
Yep.
I believe that's the big feud with the SST. So now I'm traveling. Yep. Had the connection with Tonga, connection through my friend, connection through the school. Still haven't made it in the business, still trying. Now I'm in my middle 20s, already behind the walls, if you know what I'm talking about.
Okay.
So we're driving down to the Baltimore Arena. Okay. It's actually leaving the arena. It's after the matches. We've got quite the buzz. Out of nowhere, as I'm driving, Fatu is sitting behind me. Right across the side of the head while I'm driving, Professor. Literally thought it was going to knock me out the window. Stunned, car all over the road. I was a pretty big guy. I was a tough son of a bitch back then. But listen, that was Rikishi Fatu, the Samoan Steiner, legendary. I don't take any shit from anyone. I don't back down from anyone. I'm a man of respect. You know that.
Yep.
So he, you know, being under the chemical influences doesn't always help. I say that all the time. I don't advocate any of that. That certainly didn't help. So he thought I was disrespecting him. I turned around, Professor, and I slapped him. I don't
think
shit from anyone. Pulled over to the side of the road. He said, pull the car over. We get out of the car. We're right in front of a car dealership. Big plate glass window. I thought he was going to throw me through it. We're going around the car. He said, you disrespect me, this, that. And I'm trying to explain to him. Now, we're inebriated, especially him. I'm trying to explain to him. How would I never would disrespect you guys or anything like that. That's why I'm here. We're traveling as a family together, learning the business. And it was all a misunderstanding. My buddy had to intervene, but Fatu almost got his hands on me, thought I was being disrespectful. We came, even under the inebriation, we came to our senses. He didn't kill me or throw me through the plate glass window. We went across the street to the restaurant. He ended up apologizing to me. I was literally brought to tears because I thought that he thought I disrespected him, which I'm a man of respect, and that's the way I live my life. So fast forward to the next day. This is where the story gets better, and I'm the most humbled and honored guy. And thank God Fatu didn't kill me, and how much I learned on the road with those guys. They're getting ready to go out against the Road Warriors. Here comes Animal and Hawk backstage. Now I'm sitting there in the bleachers backstage. I'm next to the Samoans, my buddy. Here comes Animal and Hawk. Unbeknownst to me, I don't know what they talked about. I have no idea. And here's Hawk. Hey, Big Daddy. I heard you got in a little scrap last night. It's that Road Warrior Hawk voice. Now, me, I didn't get into a scrap. Fatu probably would have killed me. I'm proud I stood up to what was a misunderstanding. Right. Right. But to have the legendary Road Warriors come over and recognize me and say that to me. Now, it was a rib. They were probably laughing about it. Hey, you know what I'm saying? But yep. To get that kind of acknowledgement to be there, and you know, and Junior Fatu just looked at me and gave me the wink, and it was the most incredible feeling I ever had in my life to be recognized. And then we went on the road after that, and you know, being in the restaurants and the bars with Ron Simmons and Butch Reed and the Road Warriors, and hanging out and Michael Hayes and learning the business. That was my second attempt, and that story right there is something I'll never forget, Professor.
1989, the NWA WCW had an incredible lineup. It was probably one of their best years, probably the last great year, being especially with the Flair Steamboat feud and stuff. So what happened there? Did you have a tryout with them?
Well, I went there to learn the business. The Samoans had vouched for me. Okay, and this is where I was going to transition into trying to be a manager, because I wasn't sure if I was going to make it as a pro.
Right.
This is where... Could you imagine me as an independent guy who never signed a contract, who didn't make it as a full-time wrestler? I didn't know it at that time, but yet was legit enough behind the walls, if you know what I'm talking about, to be sitting there in a room with Luger and Sting and all those guys. It was just was overwhelming. It was just basically there for me to get to know the boys, to learn the business so I can introduce myself, because I didn't make it as a grappler and was going to try the WCW way. And that's where I met Rick and Scott Steiner long before Scott Steiner ever got into the business and was Big Papa Pump. It was the most incredible things hanging out backstage. We were very similar trying to learn the business. And he was Scott Steiner, obviously, collegiate grappler, all-star. I couldn't carry his jockstrap, but just to run in those circles and to be with those guys and to learn from those guys, that's why I think that I had a degree of success. And that was right. My second attempt to get into business. Now, remember, I've said this many times, Professor, and for your fans out there, I've retired and come back in this business more times than you know, whether it be Brett Favre, Michael Jordan, or any professional wrestler or any sport. I've retired and come back like five or six times, Professor.
I've seen you quite a bit
about my dreams. I never gave up.
That's amazing. I've seen you quite a bit over the years, you know, in different promotions from Northeast Wrestling, CCW. And were you part of Power and Glory Wrestling when Roma was running that too, or no?
I was not a part of Power and Glory. I went back into the business heavy after that late trip in the late 80s.
Right.
CCW. I started a family. I had two children by 1990, was married. Had to stay with the bread and butter behind the walls for 25 years. That's what paid. So that also was the reality of the business, putting money on the table, supporting your family, not being able to make it, and yet never giving up on your dreams and keeping that steadiness of behind the walls, which has set me up for the rest of my life.
Right.
So early 91, I'm back at it again, and this is where I get full-blown into the manager part of it.
Right.
And I start knocking on doors. I actually went into face paint and got that from the Road Warriors. And I was a professional wrestling manager wearing face paint like the Road Warriors back in the early 90s.
Yep.
Now, I also was known for not a full-time grappler, but I was a 330-pound man. I could take a couple of bumps. So that's what I ended up becoming famous for. I took big bumps. I would always take the big bumps in the matches and was able to main event with all the stars. Because I was such a big guy, I molded my career after a combination between Captain Lou and Jesse Ventura. Now, I've consulted and learned with everybody from Gary Hart to Jim Cornette to Bill Alfonso to Captain Lou himself. I mean, to J.J. Dillon recently. I've tapped everybody I can for the wrestling business, plus the training itself. So I was able to knock on every door. I sent videotapes to the WWE, NWA, Harley Race, Dusty Rhodes, the Smoky Mountain Wrestling, every territory you could think of. And I ended up working for a lot of them later on in the middle and late 90s, like ECW and AWA Superstars and the NWA. So that's where I really had a lot of success. And I can't even believe we're talking about it. It's the most I've ever talked about my career ever, you know, because it's for me, Professor, it's about putting other people over. That's what the Guardian of Chaos does. I don't like to always shill for myself or brand myself, although in this business, if you don't, you'll never get anywhere. So I almost feel humble telling my story because I'm here. What I do best is putting other people over.
Right. Okay.
And that's what I enjoy doing best is putting other people over. That's what I'm good at. I'm a good mouthpiece and I'll take the bumps. So getting back and to tie this up and go through my career further, it was the early 90s where the Guardian of Chaos, Big Daddy, really took hold on the managerial scene. And I was able to travel all over, which led me into the later into the 90s where I traveled on everybody else's dime and got paid more than a lot of the workers were the actual full-time wrestlers.
Right.
So, I mean, I perfected a couple of bumps. I perfected about 5 bumps that I could take. And it flew off from there. And I probably had the most success out of any independent professional wrestling manager, maybe in the history of the business. That's my opinion and what I've been told
right.
by other big companies.
That's amazing. I know you've worked with quite a bit. When did you work for the NWA? During the later 90s era when it was Tony Rumble? And
correct. I worked for everyone from Howard Brody.
I remember him.
Who was the president of the NWA to Tony Rumble. I worked for NWA New Jersey, NWA New York, NWA New England, NWA, I can't even remember all, NWA Mid-South.
Mm-hmm.
And whatever different NWA groups there were, that's when Brody had broken up the original. I never worked for Brody's the original NWA.
Yeah. But
the NWA that we knew it in
growing
the
80s, up.
When
yeah.
I went and saw WCW and NWA when I was trying to learn the business. I didn't work for the Crockett's, is what I'm trying to say. But I worked for the NWA territories and also the AWA with a fake Ganya relative. But it was a great time out in the AWA. Justin Roberts. That's where I met Justin Roberts.
I remember the AWA. They used to have an affiliate somewhere here in Connecticut, and I went to one of their shows probably 20 years ago. But I forgot.
Professor, you've been around. That's why I agreed to do your show. I do a lot of podcasts. I do a lot of radio shows. I have my own show with a very famous guy. I'm on national radio. I'm trying to get bigger and brands, but I'm on here for one reason, because I get many requests, Professor. I'm on here because of who you are, not only as a person, because you're a good person, you're a salt of the earth.
Thank you.
But because of, it's the truth, Rick. I don't blow smoke up people's ass. I tell it like it is.
That's right.
You're a historian. You do your research. You've been around the business. You have respect. You're well-respected. So you're a guy who's humble and laid back, but has a lot of knowledge. I don't go on just any podcast or any show or any YouTube platform, but I came on here because of your reputation and who you are in the business that a lot of people don't know about.
I appreciate that, because actually when I started putting this thing together, you're one of the first people I thought of about coming up here too. So
I could talk forever.
Tell me a little bit about working for Northeast Wrestling and Mike Lombardi. You worked there for a long time.
I worked for Northeast Wrestling for damn near 10 years. For as long as Mario Mancini was in the WWF, I was with Northeast Wrestling, because there's a little history there. We always laugh about it, Northeast Paradise Alley. It's all bullshit. I worked for Northeast for about 10 years, and let me tell you, from the rip, from the very first day I walked in. Now, this isn't politically correct, and I'll start a lot of heat here. And I really don't give a fuck, to be quite honest with you, because I tell it like it is. I was treated well by Northeast. I was traveled all over the Northeast area on their dime. They paid for my hotels, my food, and I can't tell you my fee, because I got paid more than most of the guys on the roster, unless it was a Samoa Joe or AJ Styles or Kurt Angle or the Dudley Boys.
Mm-hmm.
I was able to be put in every main event. It led on to bigger and better organizations. And the one thing I could say about Northeast is they took a chance on me. They let me come in and be one of the featured managers, because back then it was Kenny Casanova, a pretty talented guy.
Different. I remember that.
Paul Adams, who just recently passed away, was a good manager.
I heard about that. I remember him. Yep.
Two good guys. But they're more along the lines of a Jimmy Hart, Grand Wizard. There's nobody like the Guardian of Chaos. There just wasn't. You talk about Joel Gertners and Bill Alfonso's and people like that. I was in barbed wire matches, thumbtacks, fire, not afraid to be to take the bumps. So Northeast led me into a lot of other groups because of their work and having a platform.
Yep.
Treated me great, gave me a chance, paid me well from the rip. I didn't even have to have a tryout. I had a couple of people vouch for me that had good reputations. The Jackmaster, John Diamond.
Yep.
Tough Tony DeVito. Roughhouse Ralph Mosca. The Giant Primo Carnera. These people vouched for me. I went in there, and my very first bout, we were on the same show with George the Animal Steel, so it doesn't get any better than that. And I was with DeVito and Roughhouse Ralph Mosca. And from there, it just flew on to where I was able to work with Kamala, Dusty Rhodes, Sergeant Slaughter, King Kong Bundy, Yokozuna, Rikishi, Umaga, Just Incredible, Christian Cage, the Monster Abyss. I mean, I can't even name the people that I've been able to work with, which led me on to a lot of other legendary groups like the AWA, like I said, the NWA, World Wrestling Association, and then a lot of local groups here where we had a lot of fun that you know a lot of local groups too.
So
it was a lot of fun. I'm humbled. And again, my experience with Northeast, to wrap up that question, is nothing but positive. Now, what has happened after I got out of the business? That's all politics and bullshit that I don't really care to.
We don't have to talk about that.
I was treated well by Northeast, and I'm forever in their debt. And I really had a chance to work with some unbelievable people, even local guys that were stars and still are stars that I consider brothers. You talk about guys like Kurt Adonis.
Yep. You
talk about guys like Ron Zombie. Mm-hmm. I mean, talk about guys like Bull Dredd. I mean, these are guys that are lifelong brothers of mine that I also had a chance to work with in Northeast Wrestling. So, you know, Kurt then inducted me into the Hall of Fame. So, I mean, it doesn't get better than that. I've had some lifelong friendships from there.
You're part of you've mentioned the Hall of Fame a couple of times. You were inducted in 2019, correct?
Just last year, thank God, because with this pandemic and all this stuff, different stuff, who knows? It was the biggest honor of my life. I was inducted into the class of 2019 New England Pro Wrestling Hall of Fame. Joe Bruins, New England Pro Wrestling Hall of Fame, which I never thought about, which I knew about, but I never thought about. I never politicked. I never asked. It was approached to me, and I was told that when my name was brought up, I was a no-brainer. So to be in the Hall of Fame as a professional wrestling manager, and if you look at the people in that Hall of Fame, everybody from Harley Race to Roma to Mancini to Greg the Hammer Valentine, that there's so many unbelievable legends in the New England Pro Wrestling Hall of Fame. That's the biggest, one of the biggest achievements, if not to be in, for my career to be inducted. It's solidified. I've been out of my career since 2007. And so I can't describe it. That night was unbelievable, that whole weekend. And, you know, you're immortalized forever, Professor. And that's what we're looking to do. And it's your legacy now. No one can ever take that away from you. I've said this a million times. I never worked for Vince McMahon. I never signed a contract for the WWF, the WWE. But the people I've worked with and the people I've met and the brotherhoods and the bonds and the stories that I have and being inducted into the New England Pro Wrestling Hall of Fame and being voted Manager of the Year a couple of times, being in magazines, being on TV shows, being on Jerry Springer, Ricky Lake, making movies, they could never take that away from me. And that's why I did it. Take away the money. Take away the contract, the notoriety. It's all documented. It's all on video. It's all photos. And I could die today, Professor, God forbid. And that's what it's all about for the career. I mean, I couldn't ask for more. I'm so blessed and fortunate. I really am.
No, you had a great career. Now, you've mentioned being on Jerry Springer, and I've seen the clips. I've seen the clips. I saw this back then when it originally aired. I knew who it was. Because I knew you back then, but how did that come about, and what was that all about, you going on there?
Well, listen, since kayfabe is dead, I signed the agreement years ago. There's no longer kayfabe. I was doing a lot of managing and making appearances out in the Midwest. I was in Las Vegas, I was in Indiana, I was in Chicago, I was in Wisconsin, I was in Minnesota, and that was all courtesy of the World Wrestling Zone. The AWA superstars, Steve and Larry Gligorovic, the twin turbos, heaven and hell from the WWE, and Justin Roberts. They brought me out there. They had seen me on videos. Again, I had knocked on every door, Professor. I had sent out countless video tapes. I had been thrown out of the front office of the WWE. I mean, it's just a fact. They knew who I was. They thought I was talented. It just, you know, for what I did, it was transitioned out later on, and we could talk about managers. So they saw me on a video, and I get a call out of nowhere from Toby Yoshimura. Konnichiwa for all my Japanese friends. Listen, the Guardian of Chaos has a huge following in Japan, my friend. Trust me when I tell you. So Toby calls me up. He was the producer for Jerry Springer. And he said, Big Daddy, he said, would you be interested in coming on a Jerry Springer show? And I was like, sure, but I don't have a story.
Right.
He said, hey, listen, we saw you on a bunch of videos from the Midwest. And he said, we're very impressed with your character. So I'm listening. I said, yeah, sure. He goes, we have some storylines for you to pick from. I said, what? I said, Springer's not real? So they ran down. They thought I was a talented guy. They ran down four different scripts for me to pick out which one I wanted to be. I could make believable.
Right.
And I said, well, okay, but since I work behind the walls and I am who I am, I have a family, I can't do anything, you know, storyline that's going to be compromising.
Right.
And so they let me pick my own storyline. They flew me out there, treated me like Elvis, limos, girls, hotels, food. I hooked up with, on the same show with Anthony from the Pitbulls from ECW.
I remember
Little,
Gene,
yep. Little Genie Sweet Destiny from WCW. Several porn stars. And then the unbelievable Iron Sheik was on the same show with the Guardian of Chaos. So they flew me out there. They gave me a screen test. We picked from a story. They hooked me up with this other guy who was a grabber. Look, I'm wrapped in chains, kid. I'm always wrapped in chains, man. It's unbelievable. So we get out there, and they give me the script, and we're on national TV in front of like 6 million people. I said, let me be the Guardian of Chaos. Let me be Big Daddy. I talked to Springer personally. He agreed to. I didn't have to be who I am. I could be my gimmick, kayfabe. And I was able to be Big Daddy and do a storyline. And we're the clothing company that I had represented out of Malvern, Pennsylvania, the Big Daddy Clothing Company. I represented them. They supported and covered me with everything from head to toe. Another company that I took care of me. How I ever fooled these people, Del Santo. Professor, how I ever fooled all these people, whether it be Springer, Ricky Lake, all the different movies I've been. I pulled it off.
That's good.
I was able to pull it off. So it was an unbelievable experience. I got to hang out with Dennis Rodman at the Crowbar. I want you to picture this. We're with a bunch of suits in a limo, Chicago. It's after the show, drinking some Jack Daniels in a limousine. Somebody lit one up.
All right. Yep.
We go to the Crowbar, the infamous Crowbar. That's right by the House of Blues out there in Chicago, too.
We ended up
too. So I get in there. Now, Dennis Rodman's in the VIP room. Now, you know it's a freaky place that Rodman's there. The Crowbar. I want you to research this, fans.
Yeah, I'm going to.
So I get challenged and dared. I'm half in the bag. They have this thing there. Two wooden poles, Professor. And they tie you up by leather straps to the wooden poles. They strip you down to your underwear. It's part of the gimmick in the bar. So I'm stripped down to my underwear. I agreed to do it. Tied with leather straps to two posts. And here come three hot chicks with hot candle wax. I'm there in my moudons. I might have had a hard on. I'm not sure. Pouring hot wax on my nipples in front of the whole bar. And then they took out ping pong paddles, Professor. And they ping pong paddled my whole body, even my testicles. In front of everybody like
this. Oh, my God.
Hot wax and ping pong paddles on the whole body. And let me tell you something, Del Santo, the greatest night of my life. I ended up in a VIP room with Dennis Rodman. That's another story for another time.
Wow.
Let me tell you something. It was the time of my life. And I actually ended up booking for Jerry Springer. I ended up getting a bunch of my friends on there. And for everyone that I booked as a guest, I got paid. So that was an incredible experience. It's amazing tales. You can see it on my Twitter. You know I'm very active on Twitter. It's at Big Daddy GOC. And the GOC stands for the Guardian of Chaos. And fans, if you want some content with no political bullshit, no sexual bullshit, no bullshit in general, no slander, nothing but positivity and telling it like it is, follow me on Twitter and you'll see what I'm talking about. I'm also on YouTube. We're working on that. But, you know, listen. I got to jerk off the dog to feed the cat. You know how that goes. You know how that is, right?
Absolutely.
Yeah, and listen, we're not going to get thrown off the air by the FCC, are we?
No, we'll put out a warning.
Put on the parental guidance suggestion.
There you go. You're cracking me up.
Professor, where were we? We're 90s. We're mid
90s wrestling. Yeah. Mid 90s.
The Guardian of Chaos. We're going to wrap up my career because we've spent way too much time on my career. We really did, my friend. I want to talk about current stuff and I want to keep the fans.
Absolutely.
Sure. We went into the late 90s, into the early 2000s. I got out in 2007. I worked with over 40 or 50 Hall of Famers. I've worked with every big star you could think of. It's a who's who in professional wrestling. Whether it was the three stars and beyond the mat, Mick Foley, Terry Funk, Jake the Snake Roberts, I've worked with them all. The whole Samoan dynasty. So the list goes on and on from legends like Killer Kowalski. And I can't even go on with all of this. We'll be here for an hour. But I'm humbled, and I appreciate you asking about my career. I had a long, illustrious career. I was the most well-known unknown, definitely the most notorious professional wrestling manager in this industry. It was a great career. I don't regret any of it. I have no qualms. I'm not bitter. I'm old school. And I retired in 07. I was getting ready to go on a Heroes of Wrestling tour. I walked away on my own terms. I'm grateful for anyone who ever let me work with them, trusted me with their body, and I trusted them with my body. I worked with so many people that I can't thank. It's unbelievable. And if you see my Hall of Fame speech and you go out to New England Pro Wrestling Hall of Fame or All Access Entertainment or my Twitter in general, you'll see all the stuff that I've done. And I can't thank you enough for asking me about that. And now, 2015, I got back into the business, and I'm helping out with Paradise Alley, doing all their vignettes and their color commentary and broadcasting. And we even brought back, after the Piper's Pit, the legendary Chaos Corner.
I was there for the last one. Yeah. I was there for the last one with Mr. Bob Backlund. That was quite the event.
Now listen, give me your thoughts, because I value your opinion. Give me your thoughts on the whole Bob Backlund. First off, I worked with Backlund back in the 90s, so it was great to have him there and to be in the ring after being out for so long, to have a legend agree to come on with me. That just goes to my credibility and what people think of me, and I'm humbled by that. But what did you think of that? And then to have Collusion come out, give me your thoughts. You were there live on Friday the 13th, which was the Ray Hercules Hernandez Memorial Tournament for Paradise Alley.
I thought it ended up being a really good show. The segment was fun. That's definitely a way to put it. I had a chance to talk to Bob a little bit. Now, first time I ever met him was in like 1992. I wrestled for Amity High School, and he was the coach of Rocky Hill High School wrestling team. And that was the first time I ever met him. And so I reintroduced myself, and it's kind of off his rocker now at this age. So,
listen, was he nuts that night?
Yes, absolutely. As nice as he was, he was just, I was like, okay. And it was like one of those things where I had to try to find an excuse to walk away kind of thing. Because then once he started talking, yes.
I mean, I really, it was great to have him at Paradise.
Absolutely. Alley. Absolutely.
But yeah, Bob's a great guy, but I think a lot of it's a work. And
yeah,
if we have time, I wouldn't even mind running over that Hercules Hernandez Memorial Tournament. But what I would like to talk about, because I want your opinion on this, and I know you're interviewing me, but I always end up interviewing you.
Yeah, no, I'm quite all right with that.
Your thoughts, because I want to bring this up because it's very important to me. Your thoughts on Dino Costa and my platform, because we just talked about it, Chaos Corner.
Yep.
I'm on every Thursday night on the Worldwide Dino Costa Show. You can go out to thedinoshow.com. He's on Monday through Thursday. A former Sirius XM host, very famous, very infamous, very controversial. Your thoughts on Chaos Corner and then on the Dino Costa Show, because I really want your opinion on
that. Honestly, I'm going to tell you, it's the segment of the show that I enjoy the most. I actually tune in every week. If I don't catch it live, I usually listen to it the next day. I've sent in questions to ask you questions. And it's fun to listen to, especially knowing your knowledge and your history in the business, and to talk about current product and where the business lies today. especially, you know, it's going a little crazy right now, especially with this pandemic hitting and such. Wrestling was on 2019 and early 2020 was such a great year for professional wrestling. And
it really was.
And then the pandemic hit, and then it just, it turned everything upside down. It doesn't, like I said before, I didn't want to talk about anything, so we're not going to bring it up, but it's getting, seems to be.
Well, you know what? What it is, Professor, is it's something that obviously it's your show. It's something that we could touch on. I mean, it's the big elephant in the room, and I find
right.
all the different shows that I go on and the different podcasts, we don't focus on negativity, even on Mario and Chaos, but
you
have to address the current issue, move on, move forward. Hey, listen, again, we had talked prior to your show that we weren't going to talk about this stuff, but Professor, it is current, whether it's the crazy stuff from Jimmy Havoc and AEW or allegations of Jim Cornette and this and that. We don't have to talk about it, but then throw in the pandemic and what's going on. I mean, it's a subject that's a hot topic, and we could talk about the pandemic. I mean, how much it's changed just, the landscape of the business.
It's just pure insanity, especially the last 48 hours, all the crap that's been happening. And then you hear things about certain guys. Some of them, you don't know what to believe. Some of them looks like it might be from a bitter ex. Some of it could very well be true. I'm not going to be an asshole and say, I'm siding with the victim side or siding with the, you know, the accused.
I'm going to say this to you, okay? Because I've been in the business a long time.
So
hold on one second. Let me, because I have to put this on to address.
Sure.
This, okay.
Getting in character.
Well, I'm going to say this because it's a touchy subject, okay? And it's something that, you know, I'm going to talk about. I've been in the business a long time. And you can even, I joke about it in my Hall of Fame speech with my wife, with two former WWE stars, the Heartthrobs, Romeo Roselli and
Antonio Thomas. Yep.
Two stars, two guys that are unbelievable. And as a joke in my Hall of Fame speech, they were sitting, you know, two handsome guys sitting next to my wife. And I made a joke out of it. And I think about it now. And I thought about it over the last 48 hours. And that's why I'm bringing it up here. I had said jestfully to Romeo and Antonio, to Heartthrobs, I mean, doesn't get six died for these guys in the WWE. So as a joke, you know, we're all there as a work. Four horsemen are there, Roma, Mancini. So I'm giving my speech and I say, hey, Roselli, be careful next to my wife. You know, my wife starts turning red. She's blushing. And Romeo moved over one spot. I said, hey. I said, come on now. And then Antonio, I said, look, and I got Antonio Thomas on the other side of the Heartthrob. And I said to my wife, I said, you don't know how lucky you are. And then Thomas gets over in the middle of the speech. And now Romeo and Antonio are on the sides of my wife. So I'm joking. I say, honey, she's embarrassed. And everyone's laughing and smiling the whole room. Okay. Because it was a little lighter sense back then. And I said, honey, get down on your knees and be lucky and be thankful. I said, this is what women in this business and industry dream for. This is what the rats used to dream for, the Heartthrobs. And I made that comment, and the whole room busted because we all knew what we were talking about, because it's just like, and this is a matter of a fact, this is a statement. Now, listen, and I apologize to you, Professor, but I'm going to bring it up.
Go ahead.
I'm not all for, obviously. Listen,
right.
I have daughters. I have a wife. Not into the whole sexual harassment thing. I'm not about that. Be a man. Be who you are. Respect people. Doesn't matter your color, your culture, your creed, your gender, your race. I say it all the fucking time on every show that I'm on. Okay? But we all also have to learn to lighten up, and people have to step up for themselves and don't be victimized. And when I say that, I don't mean that towards the victims, but the business is just like the rock and roll industry and just like the entertainment industry, and professional wrestling is just like that. They're called groupies. And I'm not talking about people taking it, and I'm not talking about people assaulting people, and I'm not talking about people going against consensual. It's not what I'm talking about, because that it's a raw bone with me. I'm talking about what most of these people, it's a consensual thing. I'm not saying I condone it or agree with it. It comes with the rock and roll business. It comes with professional wrestling. Yes, it's a derogatory term saying rats and groupies and stuff like that.
Right.
But is this what we've come to? These are people and women and men, whoever did this, who chose to do it, for the most part, as far as I understand or what I ever witnessed, on their own doing. So to see all this come out, it strikes a chord in the professional wrestling business. It's well documented and it's well known about things like that happen. And I don't begrudge anybody for outing people or coming out and telling your story. You should. You should.
Yes. Yes.
But that's a part of this business and not the assaults, not the harassment. That's not what I'm talking about. But as far as all the other stuff, and that's to my joke, and I really had to go back and think about what I said in my Hall of Fame speech, even with my wife there, about groupies and about rats and what's happened over the last 48 hours. Society has changed. Things have changed. We've seen that through the protests and the riots and the pandemic, and they want to take away history and wipe out history, right, wrong, or indifferent. Agree, don't agree. That's not my place to say. I have my own opinion, and it is what it is.
And that's what you're allowed. Yeah, you're allowed your own. Yeah,
correct.
Go ahead. Correct. Go ahead.
I'm proud to be who I say this in general to people, and I taught this to my family. Identify and be welcoming to everyone. Do not judge anybody by where they come from, what they look like, what they did, who they are, what they're about, what they represent. You treat people the way you want to be treated, how they are to your face. Okay? It's just that simple. And I say it all the time, and I'm going to say it again. It's about respect. And in order to get respect, you have to start with respecting yourself. Once you do that, you open up other people's minds to respecting you. Be proud to be who you are. Identify with everybody else. Don't try to be something that you're not. And be proud to be who you are. And that's my message about all this stuff. And we can get back onto some lighthearted stuff.
And I'm just saying that the whole business in the 48 hours. Yeah.
Professor.
Well, like I said, you know,
you didn't
there's times.
Address it.
You're right. We talked about that before we started recording. And like I said, some of it I believe, some of it I don't. And I'm not, like I said, I'm not trying to be a dick and trying to be like a tough guy. I mean, you gotta, it's really hard to talk about. You know, it's just some of these guys I definitely do believe. Some of them I think could just be people looking for a buck or stalk. Like, I believe the one, I don't know how true this is, and this is just my opinion that,
well,
like, say the guy, like, Matt Riddle, it looks like he had problems with this woman before, and it, you know, even though that there was supposed text messages that came out, something's not adding up in my head. But then there's like other guys that it's just blatantly obvious that's what happened, you know what I mean? Like, so, but
I don't like the whole, and you made a very valid point before the show.
Yeah.
I don't like the whole he said, she said stuff. And it's too easy on social media and all these platforms to get into toxicity and negativity. But with that being said, especially coming from where you are, you're a guy right now who has a show. You're a historian.
Yeah.
You're a researcher. You're a professor. You do your research. So I would be remiss if I didn't say to you that you almost, in your position as a journalist, almost have to cover this stuff.
Yeah. But like I said, I try to focus on positivity, not negativity. Didn't necessarily want to bring it up, but it's okay. We're sitting here talking about it. It's just that I have a family. I don't want this shit to happen to my family. You know what I mean?
That's a valid point.
And I think that one of the things that really gets me is that it's these simple words that can ruin a guy's entire career, whether true or not. You know what I mean?
I agree.
And they're just taking sides, whether it's true or not, and just guys are getting released without any concrete proof, and if it actually happened. So, and like I said, for people that are listening, it's not necessarily that
I
believe
it. Well, the ratings are going through the roof
it.
Right now, Professor. Yeah. Okay, the Guardian of Chaos is on. The ratings are going through the roof. You get one more.
There you go. It's going to be my most listened episode. But yeah, it's like I said, I don't want to necessarily think that these guys are all bad and that they're all, or some of them didn't do it and then some of them do, but I just have my opinions about certain guys, especially guys that I've encountered, you know what I mean? But we don't know what some of these guys are like behind closed doors though as well. That's another thing.
Those are valid points. And again, you know, as a guy who's in the position of you are as being a reporter right now in this industry, I believe it's something that you had to cover. You did a great job on that. Now I want to ask you this question. We go back and forth. I'm on your show, but again, I want to get your feedback because you're a guy that's out here on social media. Because I briefly caught the first show because I was also doing another show.
Yep.
But our head trainer at Paradise Alley, pretty wonderful. Four horsemen, Power and Glory, Young Stallions, Pretty Paul Roma, the head trainer at Paradise Alley, has started his own show.
I saw it's going to be on Twitch, and I'm kind of getting excited to watch that.
Professor. He's going to be on Twitch, and he's also on Facebook Live.
Okay.
The first show was this past Wednesday. It's called Maintaining the Truth, and it's on 7 to 8 o'clock every Wednesday with Avi Klein, who I guess is a pretty big guy in social media. So you got to listen. If Roma says it, I can't say it enough to your fans and your audience out there. If Roma says it, put it in the books. Maintaining the Truth with Paul Roma every Wednesday night, 7 o'clock on Twitch and on Facebook Live.
Yeah, you're going to have to listen. I'm going to have to watch that and check it out. I go back on Facebook and watch that probably later on today. Got a lot of stuff coming up. So tell me more about the Mario and Chaos show. How long you guys been doing that?
Well, that's I'm glad you brought that up. I greatly appreciate that for giving us the press and the coverage. Mario and Chaos, we are coming up on episode 66, which I believe we'll be taping next week because our producer, who worked for Vince McMahon in the late 80s, early 90s, Mr. Paul Perez, who was supposed to be going into the New England Pro Wrestling Hall of Fame this year, but obviously it's been canceled because of the pandemic, but we'll get him in there. Paul Perez is our producer. He's on hiatus down in Myrtle Beach right now.
A much needed
break, yes. Episode 66, season 2. So we've done a lot, Professor. We're coming up on the completion of our second year. We'll be starting season 3. It originally started off as a weekly podcast, and we pretty much stuck to it. And we had a phenomenal young broadcaster on at one time, and that would be Matt the Kid Degnan.
Yep.
It's Open Table Sports, and a guy who has gone on to do great things with Boston Wrestling and the MWF and Dan Marotta up there and Tony Atlas. And he's done a lot of things with Connecticut School of Broadcasting and the Chargers and the Milwaukee Brewers and Boost Oxygen. And let me tell you something about the kid. He was on season 1, probably the first 40 episodes with us. And I hope he ends up listening to this show because we only talk once in a while now because he's so busy. He was an excellent addition. He gave us that 18 to 30 demographic of new school broadcasting journalism and the business. So we started off with Mario Chaos and the Kid, season 1. And then we transitioned as the Kid went on to bigger and better things. And now we're on season 2, coming up on 66. And we've had some unbelievable guests besides the local stars at Paradise Alley. We've had Big Steve Tracy on, the Bondsman. We've had Paul Roma on. We've had MLW superstar Richard Holiday. We've had the young stars like The Haven and Zachariah Gibbs and even referees. We just had L. Ref on. We've had Bill Thompson on. And we just recently had on my good friend who was a legend in this business. Surprisingly, didn't make it to the WWE, and that was the Jackmaster, John Diamond. We just had him on 65. That was an unbelievable listen, and it's also on YouTube. But probably our biggest episode to date, Professor, was episode 63, when we had the president of the Yes Network, former WWE executive who worked for Bob Costas, Dick Ebersol, NBC Sports, created Center Stage, Yankeeography, and is right now the president of the Yankees Entertainment Sports Network, and that would be Mr. John Filippelli. He gave us almost 2 hours. And if you're a baseball fan and want to know the inner workings of baseball and the WWE front office, John Filippelli, the legend, in episode 63 was an unbelievable listen. And now that we're on YouTube, I mean, I got to admit, Professor, I scare the rats off cheesecake. I mean, I make onions cry. I mean, you know what I'm saying? It's not easy to... And with Mancini, I mean, he literally looks like a friggin' bulldog. His face, his chin takes up the whole friggin' screen. So, I mean, what I'm going to say about our podcast, our show, because I like to consider it a show and a podcast all into one. We are different than anybody else. Hey, listen, there's a lot of great shows out there. You're competing with guys like Bruce Prichard and Eric Bischoff and Taz and Tony Schiavone and Conrad Thompson and Tommy Dreamer. And I could go on and on and on about the different podcasters out there. There's a lot of great shows. But what is different with us is that we had guys and have guys that have credentials from Vince McMahon and the World Wrestling Federation, and then throw in my credentials of being 30 years in the independent scene and all the different hats that I've worn, and then throw in our explicit content and our road stories, because we don't really talk about the current state of professional wrestling unless it's independence. We are a different podcast and a show than anybody else out there. We're not better than anyone. We're different. And if you listen to us, it's a combination of not being that serious, but a lot of chicanery, a lot of road stories, a lot of brotherhood, and a lot of current information on Paradise Alley Pro Wrestling. I mean, that's what I get from our show, and hopefully it continues, Professor.
I hope so. I enjoy listening. I have to get caught up. I think I'm a couple episodes behind, but I do listen, and eventually I do get caught up. Ever since this,
you're a busy guy.
Well, ever since this pandemic started, to be honest with you, I'm way behind on a lot of stuff because I'm working from home now. There's also the little guy here, you know, so I'm not necessarily able to listen to everything. I haven't even caught up on this week's AEW yet. So that's another thing I haven't. I don't know if you saw that or not. Did you watch that AEW this week?
Professor, let me hold on now, Professor. Hold on here. Because I am a man of a thousand masks. I am the Bill Mascaris of podcasters, professional wrestling. Here at Chaos Quarters, we have all kinds of things going on, Professor. Very, very busy guy. Very, very busy guy.
Wow.
So what were we talking about, Professor?
I asked you if you watched this week's AEW. I haven't had a chance to tune in yet, that or NXT yet. So
I am a big I'm a big fan of the product, not only because I'm in the business, but because of being on Dino Costa and being on different platforms. Yep. I have to stay current for my homework in the business. You know, I'm the biggest fan, and one of the guys that I follow who's very knowledgeable, people don't agree with him, but JD from Off the Script, JD from New York, he's an unbelievable podcast, and he's one of the guys that I get a lot of my stuff from. Put the chicken outside here, Professor. It's 100 degrees down here in Chaos
World. I know, it's crazy outside today, man.
I love it, though. I love it. Let's get back here. Where were we? Let's get back to the realm here on the Professor's show. I watch AEW every week. Yep. I find, as an old school guy, okay, I find that AEW has brought me back to where I want to be in the business in the 80s and in the 90s.
Right.
With using guys like Tully and Arn and Jake the Snake Roberts and bringing back Taz and the storyline. I say it every week on Chaos Corner, and I say it every week on Mario and Chaos. The emotional investment, the storytelling, wanting to bring you back, leaving you wanting more. That's what AEW is doing. You look at the difference between the two products during the pandemic, even before so. AEW's keeping it fresh. The locker room, its morale is high. The talent isn't even close to the WWE talent, but it's the storyline. It's the chances. It's the emotional investment and the storylines that they tell from week to week that makes you want to come back, and they're using their talent the right way. Now, do I agree with not always following the rules with the referees and the jumps, and everybody's constantly waiting there for someone to jump on them, and it's so obvious?
Yeah. Yeah,
I don't agree with a lot of that, Professor, but I will say AEW is a fresh product, and it's what I enjoy along with NWA Power and MLW as an alternative to the WWE. I mean, I really do.
Yeah, Impact. I got to tell you, I do a Tuesday night Impact review show every week now. Started a couple weeks back. Me and my buddy Danny out of Waterbury have been doing it, and I said this past week that Impact, especially with all these layoffs coming from WWE, that they're bringing some guys in, and by Slammiversary, which is July 19th, I think Impact is going to be the sleeper. It's going to be coming up there. Like, it's going to like sneak up on you and be the better product. And I think right now they've got an amazing roster, and it's totally underrated, unless you want to watch Rob Van Dam making out with his girlfriend on TV. But you know, anything else
to be said for that.
Yeah. I mean, that's what
this is what I'm going to say about Impact, and I'll say the same thing about NWA, and I'll say the same thing about MLW. We'll throw in a Ring of Honor.
Yep.
Excellent organizations with incredible talent. Stuff that I like that's not so much of the mainstream, but it's
right.
they don't have enough exposure. You're on Access TV. Most of the country doesn't get it. MLW's right. on BN Sports. Most of the country doesn't get it. NWA is only on YouTube. So how much can you – Ring of Honor, I don't even know where they are right now, especially during the pandemic.
Right. Where we – they rerun their shows Monday nights on Fight, the app. Yeah. So, I mean – but I also read yesterday that they're not coming back for the month of July yet. So they're not – and they're not renewing any contracts either. Currently, so we're gonna have to see where their state is in the coming weeks.
I've always been a big proponent of competition and yeah. having a much needed viable alternative in the industry.
It makes McMahon better. It makes the WWE better. Right. And yeah.
Now the WWE has the talent, has the roster. AEW yeah. is the product that I've latched onto, and I think it's the future. And I thoroughly enjoy it. Even during the pandemic, I find myself watching it.
They've been the better product during this pandemic because they seem to nail it right away and found their niche and how to handle the empty arena and the pandemic situation as far as continuing to put on TV shows. It's been the most consistently good TV show during this entire time.
Without a doubt. Now, I will admit over the last few weeks that Raw and SmackDown has stepped up their game. But listen, the pandemic has hurt this whole industry. We know that. But if you look at the different products, and this is what makes it a cut above. Beforehand, they were going back and forth, AEW and WWE. AEW had a long way to go. An insignificant cog in the wheel of professional wrestling to topple the mighty giant. Longevity has a lot to do with it also. They have a long way to go. But products like NWA, MLW, Impact, Ring of Honor, if they had more of a platform, they have such talent, they would be, the wrestling industry right now, before this hit, I've been saying over the last year or two, there was no better time to be in the professional wrestling business as a talent, as an owner, as a fan, than 2018, 2019, leading into 2020. All the competition, all the different exposure, all the different groups, it was exploding. It was perhaps the best time in professional wrestling that we've seen since the territory days. Right. And then all this hit, and look what's happened. And again, I can't be more of a proponent when we get out of this, and even beforehand, of watching something like NWA Power. I am such a fan of NWA, and I'm going to throw this out there right now too, fans. I'm throwing my hat in the ring for Carney Land. If anybody hasn't heard, I've already texted and emailed Billy Corrigan from the Smashing Pumpkins, Joe Galley News. Okay, unfortunately, Dave Lagana, although I like him because he's gotten back to me, but he's involved in that controversy we're talking about. Yep. I am throwing my hat in the ring for the enforcer security of Carney Land. I have advocated for Adam Rotella as the president. I am not voting for Tim Storm. Listen, all due respect to Mama Storm. Okay,
what? I'm all voting Tim Storm. I don't know.
I voted for Adam Rotella for mayor of Carney Land. No disrespect, but I am throwing my hat in the ring. Fans, go out to my Twitter. Start hitting the NWA up. The Guardian of Chaos has to be a Carney Land. So that's what I'm going to say about that. And also, besides loving that product on YouTube, I really like Studio Wrestling. It brings me back to WCW and TBS. I also am a big fan of MLW. I just wish I could see it more. And what they're doing with MLW Fusion and all the stars, whether it's Low Key, the Von Erichs, Jacob Fatu, the Dynasty of Hammerstone and Richard Holiday. And speaking of that, have you gone out and got any Dynastic coffee yet?
No, I actually just bought a coffee mug on ProWrestlingTees.com.
Well, listen, Dynasty Coffee. He's got his own coffee line now, Professor.
Now I'm going to have to – where can I get that? Where would you get
MLW.
It?
MLW.
They got it on their site? I'm doing that right after I get
it. You could
right
go after to Holiday at Most Marketable on Twitter, and it's now Dynastic Coffee. He's really pushing it, man. You know how he is with coffee.
Well, me too, actually. I'm addicted to coffee. I drink it all day, so I'm going to have to look this up.
I'm saying it right here. Holiday, if you're listening, and I know that you are, Holiday, okay? And if you're not, I'm going to make sure that I text or tweet this part to you so that you are listening, Holiday. At nauseam, I will make sure that you hear this clip. I am here with the Professor, Rick Del Santo, and the Guardian of Chaos, Big Daddy, because I tell it like it is. And I am pushing not only MLW and Richard Holiday, go out and get Dynastic Coffee. It's you want to talk about Dunkin' Donuts? You want to talk about Starbucks?
Starbucks, man.
The EarPod God now has Dynastic Coffee. Go out and get it. The professor's going to go out and get it. He's a coffee drinker. And listen, who knows? Maybe we can even get a little barista in here to make us some coffee. So, Holiday, don't forget me when you make it to the WWE or AEW. Will you please? The professor, the guardian of chaos, Dynastic Coffee.
So what else? MLW, like you said, they're definitely one of the better products out there too today. Inconsistent, have an amazing, amazing roster. Now, one of the things I just read yesterday, about 24 hours ago, is that Evolve got absorbed by WWE. Have you heard this yet?
Well,
I know you worked with them through Paradise Alley. Yeah,
Professor, I'm not surprised that Evolve got scooped up. Number one, Gabe Sapolsky was the booker for Ring of Honor, and he's very well connected
to the WWE. He did some work with ECW as well back in the day.
Correct. Yep. And Gabe was the big proponent of Evolve. And we also, and fans, you can go out and see it on YouTube. It was an insane night. Go out to Evolve 95. It was the Evolve Paradise Alley Super Show right there in East Haven, Connecticut. Not too far from here. A stone's throw away. Evolve 95, where everyone from Keith Lee to AOP. The tag team. The two big guys. It's AOP, correct?
Yes. And WWE. Yep.
And WWE. Yep. Darby Allin. All those guys were there for Paradise Alley on Evolve 95. And we were supposed to do another super show with them, but I'm not surprised because if you remember, just last year, when they were fighting the AEW effect, WWE, they brought Evolve onto the channel and they had a
remember.
Who would Evolve. So I'm not surprised by any of that. Evolve's a great group, but they were... It's kind of like a training territory. It's kind of like Ohio Valley, OVW,
right.
Where Al Snow is.
Yep.
And we had a great show that night. What an unbelievable show. That's where Darby Allin climbed up to the top of the basketball board and jumped out onto all the grapplers at Evolve. Darby Allin. Paradise Alley. I want you to look at this, Garage Rick.
Yep.
Professor Rick, if you will. I have several names for you. Let's just look at the talent that Paradise Alley Pro Wrestling has used. Not only did all the stars from Evolve, who are now in AEW and NXT, like Keith Lee, Darby Allin, the list goes on and on. I've already said it. Also, Deonna Purrazzo worked for Paradise Alley and was our women's champion, who is now in Impact and was in NXT. Yep. We've also used AR Fox, who's one of the biggest stars out there in the professional wrestling independent scene, has his own organization and probably should be in AEW or the WWE. We've also brought in Hall of Famers and legends like Booker T. We've also used guys like Matt Stryker, Bull Dempsey, Bull James, if you will, JT Dunn, Anthony Green. I mean, we've used so many big stars in the business that are relevant right now. That's what Paradise Alley is all about. And that's why coming out of this pandemic and leading into what I want to talk about, I know we're all over the place. This is what happens when you have
chaos. That's quite all right. Yep.
I'm still hoping because this is breaking news for the fans out there of Paradise Alley, because this is what we're talking about. The Taco Festivals, the Connecticut Taco Festivals, the two shows are canceled. Paradise
Alley
Pro Wrestling will not be doing the 2020 Taco Festivals. We had two big shows with big surprises, and they have both been canceled leading into the fall. We are still on schedule, hopefully, for December. For Mania 5, our WrestleMania.
Yep.
Also, it has not been gotten. They haven't, the brass, the front office, whether it be the director of operations, Sergeant Murray, Roma, Mancini, Perez, or Big Steve, they have not gotten back to me. As of today, June, the first day of summer, we are still on for Rumble in Paradise 3, which is September 12th. Now, I'm throwing it out here, but it's still hesitant. I don't know what's going to happen. I have not been told that it's canceled. September 12th, Rumble in Paradise 3. I'm just going to throw it out there.
Where was that taking place so far? Is there a building set for it?
Being booked at the JCC in Woodbridge, the Jewish
Community
Center in Woodbridge.
Okay.
So that's still on as far as I know. I also have breaking news.
Okay.
I talked to Mario Mancini today, and seeing that we're in phase two of the pandemic here in Connecticut. Phase three is until mid-July. I do believe, and obviously we'll follow CDC rules, and obviously we'll have precautions and masks and sanitizer like we did for Friday the 13th, and we were lucky.
Yep.
Now that we're opening back up, and the boys have been training and the girls have been training. I believe capacity here in Connecticut can be 25 to 50 people.
Okay.
I believe in an outdoor venue, 100 people right now. Paradise Alley Professional Wrestling is in the process right now of trying to throw and run and get together and organize an outdoor event within the next month to 2 months. During the summertime, we are trying to get an outdoor venue, perhaps at the legendary Annex Club, right there off of I-95 with the Q bridge in the background. If that's the case, Paradise Alley may be running an outdoor show within the next couple of months. Breaking news here from Mario Mancini.
That's great news because I miss me some live Paradise Alley wrestling, live wrestling in general, but I've been to almost every one of your shows in the last 2 years. So there was one I missed in the last year. So I can't wait for that. I hope that does happen for you guys.
Well, listen, we're definitely hoping that that happens. You know, there's just a lot of things going on, Professor. What else do you want to talk about? We could talk about anything. I don't even know how many minutes in we are. What do you want to know about chaos?
1 hour and 7 minutes in, and we can keep going until my phone tells me I have a low battery. So,
well, listen, I'm ready. I could talk about anything. We could talk about anything you want, from the local scene to the big scene. We could talk about anything. You know how the Guardian of Chaos is.
Let's get into some more Paradise Alley professional wrestling, because that seems to be, you know, where you are today. And that's currently my favorite promotion locally. And I love going to the shows, and I have a lot of I've made some great friends going to the shows. I've made, whether they be fellow fans or some of the wrestlers and just anybody there. You know, I've gotten to know quite a bit of people in the last couple of years, and guys like Sign Guy, Sign Kid, Don Kincaid, Mr. Trivia, all those guys, yourself, you know. So let's talk a little bit more about that. Tell us more.
Well, I'm going to tell you about the fans of Paradise Alley Pro Wrestling. Yep. And I'm going to tell you about the service that some of the journalists, reporters, super fans, dirt sheets that come to Paradise Alley. Because there's a lot of reporters, dirt sheets, super fans, local shows that come to Paradise Alley. You're included in one of them. So to have guys like the Professor there and guys like Mr. Trivia and the Nugster and the guys like the remarkable Don Kincaid and Stirring
great
the
guy.
Pot.
Yep, great guy.
His father. And then throw in the legendary Fogman with Center Ring and Commissioner Bruce. I mean, you even throw in the Radish sisters that have been there before and the legendary Leslie who dated Andre the Giant back in the day.
Oh, wow.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. We have some very famous luminaries and fans that come to our shows. And then throw in the legendary Saban family. I can't get more in touch with Kevin Saban, the Saban-toothed tiger, a giant of a man.
He's a great guy, too. Yeah.
No one to be trifled with. He is the security for Paradise Alley Pro Wrestling, Mr. Kevin Saban. And then let's talk about the Paradise Four. First off, I want to give my well wishes and my respect and my speedy recovery to the director of operations, and that would be Sergeant Murray. Sergeant Murray is a little bit under the weather. He did have an incident in his hometown, but he is recovering. You know, he's a massive man. He's a tough son of a bitch. He's no one to be trifled with, and our thoughts go out to a speedy recovery for director of operations, Sergeant Murray.
Get better, Sarge.
Absolutely. And let's run down the Paradise Four fans. And, you know, we're over an hour here on the Professor's show, and we'll wrap it up quickly. And I greatly appreciate Professor.
Oh, of course.
The platform to have me on here. The Paradise Four and what Paradise Alley does. They opened up in 2015, originally as a training facility to be carpenters, to give back. They did it as the boys to get together, to have something to do, to continue with the camaraderie and the brotherhood of professional wrestling, which is like none of it. So they did it for that. And the first student out of there was Richard Holiday, who was Roma-trained, Mancini-brained. And you see he went on to be the Paradise Alley heavyweight champion. And now he is the first star to make it out of Paradise Alley into a major organization like MLW, along with other guys who have come through passing, not necessarily trained, but worked for us. And we gave them the opportunity. And that would be MLW ring announcer Mark Adam Haggerty, who owes a lot to Paul Roma in Paradise Alley. And he has said that publicly. Mark Adam Haggerty is one of the most intelligent men that I have seen in the professional wrestling industry. Extremely talented, and his social media marketing and his seminars are something that will put you over the edge. So let's talk about him. He also, Richard Holiday, Mark Adam Haggerty. Let's also talk about Zane Lee Rude, RJ Rude, Zane Bernardo, Roma trained, Mancini brained, went on to bigger things, great things, tag team champions for Northeast, traveled all over to the UK. Look at the stars coming out now, whether it be Zachariah Gibbs, Dustin Flash Waller, Kylon King, The Haven. The future is bright. Throw in the veterans of Matias DiNapoli, the giant Vlad, who is our current champion, the House of Pain, Hakim Ali and Nick Payne, Showtime Marcel Williams, who's the only three-time winner in Paradise Alley to hold the United States champion, the Intercontinental Championship, and the Heavyweight Championship, and the first ever Hercules Hernandez Memorial Tournament winner. The only other thing that Showtime has to do is win the tag team titles. And with the Tri-State Kings, that very well may be possible. Let's run down the rest of the roster. You look at guys like the Intercontinental Champion Bull Dredd, been around for 20 years. Look at Nutrius X, our Alley Fights champion, has come back once he was off the shelf and has been incredible competitor. And I believe after he took the title from Sammy Diaz at Friday Night Alley Fights, is going to hold on to that title for a long time. All Let's talk about the United States champion, Buzz Bloodsaw, who has virtually defeated every man on the roster and perhaps the greatest champion that Paradise Alley and any title has ever known. He has competed in everything from singles matches to six-man matches to five-way dances to gauntlet matches and has still remained the United States champion. Look at the tag team division of Waves and Curls. Look at Maxim Morozov and Zafir Al-Rahihi and Collusion. They have been a thorn in the side of Paradise Alley for years, and they are nothing but trouble. And then throw in their connection with Ala Ding Ding and the Prince of Sands, Ala Dean, and that son of a bitch scumbag, Abdul Haq. And then you throw in the Pyramids of Power. There's a lot of problems from the Middle East and from the Saudi Trust over here with Collusion and the whole nine yards in the Paradise Alley roster. Let's also look at the Prophecy. Perhaps the most dangerous man on the roster, Big Jim Anderson. No one to be trifled with. So if you look at the roster of Paradise Alley and all the different people, we even have a couple people on the shelf, and I hope they come back. And that would be my good friend, the flamboyant one. Let's get jiggy with it. I'm Rick James, bitch. Kenny Roberts. I can't wait for Kenny Roberts. If anybody ever got a pop out of that crowd in Paradise Alley, no one used to do it like Kenny Roberts. And let's throw in newcomers. Let's throw in The Firm. The different guys from The Firm, whether it be Eliza Sick, Sammy Diaz, Jay Bricks, Richard Stone. I mean, these guys are nothing but a pain in the ass. Let's throw in the great Nuka Kojima, who has come in, or currently Smooth Blackman, who won the Anytime, Any Gold Gauntlet match and still has the right to cash it in against any title within the calendar year. Now, I don't know what's going to happen. Will it still extend throughout 2020? But we haven't heard much from the House of Glory star, Smooth Blackman. So those are the different guys in the roster. Give me your makeup. Is there anybody? And listen, and I failed to mention him. I mentioned him with the rookies, but I think he's still on fucking Rumspringer. And I think it's Zach Gibbs. I swear, Christmas, I thought I saw him at the Bunny Ranch in Vegas. Not that I was there, professor. Not that I was there.
The character change is definitely something different. It was not what I expected when I when he was coming out compared to his old gimmick, you know. It's definitely not what I expected. So it's pretty entertaining. It's pretty funny. But one of the guys I really like a lot is that young Flash Waller. I think that kid's got quite the future in there. He's, you know, I'm more into like the technical style, but that kid really takes a risk when he's going out there. And there's been a couple times I've been worried about the way he landed, you know.
Dustin Flash Waller is the future. If you look at... If you look at the young lions of Paradise Alley that are Roma trained, Mancini brains, I say it all the time. You look at Dustin Flash Waller, you look at Sean and Jay Haven, those guys and the risks that they take in the ring, specifically those three. And I'll throw in, although I think he's more ground technically sound, although he's in that same category of Kylon King. You throw in those four guys, that is the future of professional wrestling. I dare to say that all four of those guys, Waller, The Haven, and Kylon King, definitely make it to MLW, Impact, NWA. These guys are late teens, early 20s, and look at the talent of those men and what Roman, Mancini, Perez, and Big Steve are doing down there. And then, you know, we talk about the roster. Throwing guys that I see down at the school that help train, whether it's Big Jim or the Red Lion, Chris Battle, veteran, and then look at guys from the tag team division, which I think is unbelievable. Jose and Jose B, Team España. I mean, Waves and Curls. Look at the different teams and the different things that are going on. And back to your point of the young Lions, Dustin Flash Waller could be the next big thing out of Paradise Alley.
Absolutely. I think that kid's, like I said, I think he's got quite a future. There's also a lot of great, great talent there outside of the wrestlers. There's Ref Bill, El Ref, and my buddy, Matt DeCourt. I miss seeing all these guys every week. So,
but funny you should say that, Professor. I'm going to say this, and I've said it before on many other shows. The Zebras of Justice at Paradise Alley, and that's my boy Mikey Mambo, El Ref, probably the largest arms out of any referee in the world of professional wrestling. Senior referee, as I call him, Slick Willie, Bill Thompson. Throw in probably the most legit badass to step into the ring as a referee, and that would be Jay Mendez. He's no one to be trifled with, trust me when I tell you. And then throw in Blue Shoes, Ref Gina. The Zebras of Justice, those four, and then the occasional cue ball who has come in and substitute for us. Cue ball has been there, and then Ref Aubrey has also been in there in training. Throw in our group of referees, perhaps the best in the New England, Northeast, Tri-State area of the Zebras of Justice of Paradise Alley. They're well-trained, well-versed, and they're really incredible with the fan base and what they do for Paradise Alley.
Yeah. Very cool.
Another guy, Professor, that you talked about before I let you go, because he needs to be recognized. He learned from the tree of Mark Adam Haggerty, and he's a guy that I respect, and he's going on to work in several promotions around here, who is now the voice of Paradise Alley. And you mentioned him already, but I'd be remiss if I didn't bring his name up, because he was my former broadcast partner, and I really respect his work and what he's done, and that would be Matt DeCourt. He really has broken out of his shell and probably the hottest commodity amongst the referees in the New England-based area. He really is.
Yeah, he's a great announcer. He's going on to work for Test of Strength and WCE. Shut Up and Wrestle. Kevin Landry's. Yep. I have yet to get up there, but they seem to be putting on some good shows.
Well, all right. Kevin Landry, you know, worked for the WWE. You're well aware of that.
Yeah, you worked with him in Northeast as well, correct? I remember watching him there.
Many organizations, many different associations with Kevin Landry. A great guy.
Yep. All right. So what do you want to push? What do you want to plug, guy? Social media?
Well, we're about to wrap it up here, I'm sure, Professor. I just want to say this to everybody out there. Number one, I want to thank you. I can't thank you enough. I've had a lot of fun doing this.
Me too. I would love to.
On the rise. I look forward to your work.
I look forward
to seeing you again. Very professional, and I appreciate the platform. Number two, I want to tell everybody out there as wrestling fans and as people that please stay positive. We're going to beat this thing. We're going to beat all the craziness that's going on out there. We're going to come back bigger and stronger and better. Stay positive. Stay mindful. Believe in who you are. Don't give up hope on your dreams and who you are as a person. Stay positive, because rise above the hate and the negativity, and be proud to be who you are. With that being said, follow Paradise Alley Pro Wrestling on ParadiseAlleyProWrestling.com, Facebook at Official PAPW on Twitter. Please go out and follow The Dino Show at TheDinoShow.com, the infamous Dino Costa. He's on Monday through Thursday, 8 to 11 p.m. I am on every Thursday for an hour segment on Chaos Corner. You're not going to want to miss that. Follow Mario and Chaos Podcast. We're in Season 2. We're on YouTube, and we're on all social media platforms. You'll find nothing like it. And, of course, hit me up on Twitter, whether it be at the site where my nephew runs it, Mario_Chaos. Cut him some slack. He's still learning, okay? Or my personal site, and that's at Big Daddy GOC. And the GOC stands for the Guardian of Chaos.
All right, Big Daddy. Thank you very much.
Ricky, baby!